Bibles with me to the Gospel of John, chapter number 11. Verses 1 through verse number 16. Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus, of Bethany, the town of Mary and his sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard therefore that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. And after that he said to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest in sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. Thank you. You may be seated. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. I was scheduled to be preaching in Fort Worth this morning, but in light of the recent events that have transpired across this country and the demonstrations that are going on even right now, I believe there ought to be a prophetic word spoken to this situation by the pastor of the Lord's people at Lilly Grove Church. So I want to talk to us this morning from a sermon I preached over 20 years ago in this same pulpit entitled Lazarus and the African American Male. There are some parallels between Lazarus in John chapter 11 and the African American male experience in these United States. We are a nation of 40 million souls, African Americans, inside a nation of more than 320 million people. We don't all think the same, feel, love, learn, live, or earn the same, as is the case in every racial and ethnic people in America. There is no monolithic way of dealing with African American people. We closed a week of violence that witnessed the tragic deaths of two young black men at the hands of the police with a senseless and equally horrific ambush of the police in Dallas, Texas. Each of these images are seared in our collective consciences with mind-numbing pain. The Grammy and Academy Award-winning R&B songwriter and pianist John Legend speaks for all of us when he tweeted, "Being against cops killing is not equal to being for killing cops." Brothers and sisters, America has until yet to deal openly and honestly with the legacy of the systematic depersonalization of an entire people group known as the brutality of American slavery, nor its bastard child known as Jim Crow segregation. The nation fails to understand and appreciate the plight of young black males in our country. Riding in the car with your girlfriend and her four-year-old daughter, happened upon by the police for a broken taillight, should not end with a death sentence. Selling CDs in front of a convenience store should not mean that one is gunned down on the streets of the capital city of my home state in Louisiana. Must we come again, in the words of the Negro National Anthem, over a way that with tears have been watered? Is it possible that we must come again treading a path through the blood of the slaughtered? Unfortunately, we are not out of the gloomy past, and we are not yet to stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. America cannot understand how dehumanizing it is to African Americans to have our legitimate grievances ignored, dismissed, or discounted by tacitly suggesting that we are overreacting. We are admonished to move on and forget the wounds of the past. But telling us African Americans to move on and forget the wounds of the past, it would be tantamount to asking the Jews to forget the Holocaust and move on. It would be the same as asking Bosnians to forget the ethnic cleansing of your people and move on. It would be the same as asking Japan to forget Hiroshima and Nagasaki and move on. It would be the same as asking a Native American to forget the Trail of Tears or the massacre at Wounded Knee and move on. The Black Lives Matter movement has been largely relegated by the larger culture to a fringe organization, much like the KKK, the New Black Panther Party, and other groups that fall outside the mainstream of constructive dialogue. Their voices have at times been shrill and over the top, but that does not negate the message. And to dilute the message even further, it is obfuscated by the phrase, "all lives matter." Well, you're not saying anything to me when you say that all lives matter. They are not saying that all lives do not matter, but that black lives seem not to matter at all. You're not informing me when you say that all lives matter. All of my bones in my body matter. But if I break my arm, that's the only bone I'm going to pay attention to. all houses in your community matter, but the firemen will only show up at the house that's on fire. All lives do matter, but that does not mean that black lives do not matter. Brothers and sisters, black life is seen from a distance, as if looked at from the wrong end of a telescope. To avoid looking at us with understanding, stories about us are told and handed down through generations of prejudice. Stories like black people are lazy, dumb, immoral, hustlers, welfare queens, and crack hoes. And all we do all day long is play dominoes, drink beer, and make babies out of wedlock, and can't wait to get our hands on the flower of Southern womanhood, a white woman. When the truth is, most blacks go to work every day. Most blacks pay their bills, are college educated, many with advanced degrees, have stable two-parent homes, go to church, mind their business, and the apple of a real black man's eye is not a white woman. But the apple of his eye is the paper bag tan, a mocha chocolate, a jet black, pleasingly plump, fine as wine in the summertime, phenomenal black woman. You better ask somebody. Brothers and sisters, the notion, the very idea that we have been given everything comes from the erroneous thinking that what we demand as a citizen of this democracy and has been denied us through acts of legislation has been for white people simply by virtue of the fact that they were born white. And the ones of us who have the temerity to demand what white people fall into by birthright are called uppity niggers and too big for our britches, because we don't scrape and bow like Steppin Fetchit and Amos and Andy. Dr. Michael Eric Dyson, in a beautifully written op-ed in the New York Times, writes, "Your whiteness has become a burden too heavy for you to carry, so you outsource it to a vile political figure who amplifies your most detestable private thoughts." The dog whistles and coded language of the presumptive Republican presidential nominee, Mr. Trump, are designed to tell us in no uncertain terms, we want our country back. We want our country back. That could be accepted language were it coming from the Lakota and the Cherokee, the Sioux and the Navajo, the Comanche or the Cachado Indians, because they are the only ones to whom this country belongs. My brothers and sisters, I do not wish to be misunderstood. The tragic loss of the five police officers and the wounding of seven others in Dallas is as tragic as the young men in Louisiana and Minnesota. Death is death. I do not believe the situation is us against them. A black racist is as vile a human creature as a white racist. It's not either us or the police. It is both us and the police. I want the police to protect me. I just don't want them to murder me. But when we militarize the police force and put up the black man as an enemy, he cannot protect and serve me if I, in his eyes, become his enemy. Now, brothers and sisters, we've got to be consistent in our argument, or else it breaks down logically. The young man who did the crime in Dallas is being labeled a terrorist, and that is exactly what he is. But they didn't call Timothy McVeigh a terrorist when he bombed that building in Oklahoma. They did not call Dylan Roof a terrorist when he killed those black people in church in Charleston, South Carolina. They did not call that fool, that young white man who went in Sandy Hook Elementary and killed those children and their teachers, a terrorist. When black people kill, they are thugs, but when white people kill, they are sick. All hope would be lost if there was not a word from the Lord. And there is a word from the Lord. John chapter 11 describes one of the most hopeless cases in the Bible. Anyone looking in on the death of Lazarus would conclude that he was dead and that there was no more hope. Yet, even in the face of absolute hopelessness, Jesus demonstrates his power to step into any situation and transform it into a season of blessing. Lazarus was the brother of Mary and Martha. Jesus often stopped in their home in Bethany and reclined and enjoyed their fellowship. But now Lazarus is sick. And the text teaches us that there are in this situation some insurmountable problems. Like the insurmountable problems in the life of Lazarus, those same problems are in the lives of black young males in this country. There's the problem of disease. Weak. That's what that word disease means in the text. That's what that word sick means in the text. Totally lacking in strength. You can't send a man to Afghanistan or to war in Iraq, a war that never should have taken place in the first place, and then bring him back home without deprogramming him and sending him to work in Home Depot. I wish I had somebody to help me here. You cannot have joblessness in the community and no hope on the streets, failing schools, failing and deteriorating communities, and then expect a black young male to see that there is some hope for him. Let me say a word to us, Lily Grove. To those of us who have bought into the American dream and moved out of the hood, and gone to what white people says is the American dream. You can't make a difference where you don't make a deposit. Somebody ought to help me preach it. You can't have impact where you don't have influence. Too many of us come into the city to come to church, to get some barbecue, get your hair done, and you go back to the nice suburban walled cities and insulate and isolate your children from the troubles that's going on in this world. But hopefully when the air comes out of that balloon that you've blown up, that they recognize that if the Lord don't help us, we're not going to be able to stand the storm. The problem is disease. The problem is delay. Jesus heard from Mary and Martha that Lazarus was sick, and he could have gotten there in time. As a matter of fact, Jesus could have healed him 5 miles away, because Bethany was just 5 miles from where he was, and all Jesus had to do was speak the word. But he delayed because he knew what was on the other side of the pain. Did you hear that? He knew what was on the other side of the pain. And the Lord delays because of all this crazy talk in our community with parents letting their children decide if they're going to go to church. Come on, help me preach if you can. You can't let your children make those kinds of decisions, because they will make the wrong decision every time. You can't let them delay coming to church and delay getting an education. Our brothers and sisters, our young people have no respect for authority. They have no respect for their teachers. No respect for the principal, no respect for their elders. Talk back to me if you can. They will walk right in this church and look at me in the face and don't even speak to me, and everybody knows who I am. But if they don't respect me and you, they're not going to respect anybody. So how do you expect the police not to go after them if they got an attitude of disrespect? Yes, ma'am, will take you a long way. Yes, sir, and no, sir, will take you a long way. If they don't respect you and your home, don't expect any changes in their future. See how quiet you're getting right there? That's an insurmountable problem. And then there's the problem of death. If we're going to argue logically, the argument got to hold up on both sides. All the killing in our community ain't coming from white people. Come on, say amen if you can. We are killing one another. Our old people are scared to get out at night in their own community. They're not scared of white people. They're scared of young black boys on the street. Amen. No. All the killing that's going on ain't going on in River Oaks. It's going on in South Union, in Third Ward, on Cullen and Martin Luther King. Every street that's named after Martin Luther King across America is riddled with crime and death in the name of a man who stood for nonviolence. The church has got to accept some responsibility.
Because we in here singing and shouting on Sunday morning. Let's get out here and go tell that young black boy and that young black girl, we gonna teach you how to love yourself more than somebody taught you how to hate yourself. Pull your pants up. Take your nasty pajamas off when you get up in the morning to go outside.
Wish I had somebody to help me.
Act like you got good sense. Talk like somebody's raising you. A whole lot of our problems are self-inflicted. White people ain't breaking in my house. I wish I had a witness here. White people ain't calling black women out their name. Rappers are doing that. We buy their music. They call our women whores. And we celebrate them when they put nothing back in our community. I wish I had one or two more witnesses here. I was watching years ago, some of us remember when O.J. Simpson got in that mess with that girl. That blacks were on the street holding up signs, "Go O.J. go." O.J. ain't never fool around with no black people. I wasn't cheering for no O.J. Simpson. O.J. forgot black folk a long time ago. Talk back to me if you can. We are the only people who go and get folk who don't care nothing about us. People in the church who love us and who are trying to help us, and people in the teachers in the school who are trying to do what's right and hardly getting paid. We disrespect them and celebrate because this boy from OKC went over to play with the Warriors. That's a wonderful thing, but that ain't putting no money in our community. Steph Curry ain't invested in our community. LeBron James ain't invested in our community. It's nickels and dimes from old people on Social Security. A dollar here, $10 there. It's the people at the church who stay in the community who are making a difference. Because if my people, yeah, you can help me say it, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their land. Help ain't coming from no politician. Help ain't coming from the police. Help ain't coming from a pastor. It's coming from the Lord. My brothers and sisters, the problem here, the insurmountable problem, is death, delays, disease, and doubt. Many believers lose the battle right here in the arena of doubt. Jesus delayed coming to make sure that Lazarus was actually dead. And when he got there, Martha and Mary seemed to be fussing at him. They say, "Lord, if you had have been here," I wish somebody to help me preach. "I'm glad you showed up now, but it's too late now. I know you got the message. Thank you for coming, but what you gonna do now?" Somebody ought to help me here. And brothers and sisters, it's always too soon to give up on that black boy. It's always too soon to give up on that black girl, because Jesus ain't showed up yet. You've been trying to do with him what you could do with him, but you ain't turned him over to Jesus yet. Because in your hand, he's a fool. But in God's hand, he's a school teacher.
Let me show you how that works. Let me hurry. I'm going to show you how that works.
Put a basketball in my hand, and you ain't got nothing but a basketball in my hand. But put it in Steph Curry's hand, and he can shoot it from half court. Put a golf club in my hand, and I look like I know what I'm doing. But put it in Tiger Woods' hand, and he'll show you what a golf club was made for. You're gonna help me preach this, won't you? Put a football in my hand, and you ain't got nothing but legs on the wrong side with a football. But put it in Tom Brady's hand, and you got one of the greatest quarterbacks that ever played the game. Put a nail in my hand, and you ain't got nothing but a nail in my hand. But put a nail in Jesus' hand, and you got redemption, justification, salvation. There is therefore now no condemnation. Am I doing all right? There's insurmountable problems. But then secondly, I see some inconceivable promises. Jesus said to Martha, you're going to see your brother again. You're going to help me preach this, won't you? Martha said, I know I'm going to see him again at the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, essentially, you looking at what you're looking for. You talking to what you're talking about. You're speaking with what you're speaking of. You're standing by what you're standing on. I am. Hey. I am. The resurrection. Have I got a witness here? Deliverance comes when you recognize who the deliverer is. Death disoriented Martha and Mary. They were so distraught that they couldn't even recognize who Jesus was. And these children can exasperate us so much. They can hurt us so much. They can make us so angry with them that we forget that they are made in the image of God. And we forget that they just like us. You were crazy when you were 18 years old. Come on, help me preach it. You were a fool when you were in your 20s. You ain't had no sense in your 30s. You had to meet Jesus for you to be clothed and in your right mind. Have I got a witness here? I need somebody who's got some stuff in your past that you ain't told your children about. Because you're trying to act like you've been holy all your life. But some of us remember drinking all night long. Somebody here remember smoking dope all night long. Staying out all night long. Committing adultery and all kinds of sins. But Jesus picked you up. Turned you around. Place your feet on solid ground. And you in church shouting this morning, not because you've been so holy, but because God's been so merciful. That's an insurmountable problem. There's some inconceivable promises. Martha said, I'm gonna see him again at the last day, at the resurrection, at the last day. Jesus said, I am the resurrection. He that believeth in me, though he be dead, yet shall he live. And he that lives and believes in me shall never die. Now here is the inconceivable promise. He said, Martha, do you believe this? Because the answer to that question will make you shout right now. Dr. Frank Ray, when he was here preaching a couple of years ago, reminded us that there are 365 promises in the Bible. A promise to correspond to every day of the year. So every morning when I wake up, God got a promise for me. I will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on me. That's a promise. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. That's a promise. If you be not weary in well-doing, in due season you will reap if you faint not. That's a promise. Eyes have not seen. I wish I had a Bible reader. Ears have not heard. That's a promise. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings. That's a promise. And if you can believe that young black boy, Jesus can make a difference in your life. I got to hurry here. I want to move from these insurmountable problems and this inconceivable promise to an incredible power. Jesus went to Lazarus' grave. And when you read the scripture says he was grieved and troubled. Grieved and troubled. That word grieved in the text in the Greek means to snort like a horse. Grieved. Troubled. Troubled because of their lack of faith. And troubled because he had to wake Lazarus up from a good sleep. Let me see if I can help. He said, roll the stone away. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. He commands Lazarus to obey what he can't hear. Because he's physically dead. And until Jesus quickens him, he can't obey. But when the Lord says, come, dead folk got to get up. Is there anybody here? Used to be dead. And the Lord said, come forth. You got up from gambling. You got up from stealing. You got up from lying. You got up from living wrong and came to Jesus because he said, Lazarus, Terry, Charles, James, Carlos, Fitzgerald, come forth.
Every time I read that scripture, every time I read that scripture, I start shouting. Because Jesus had to call Lazarus by his name. Stop calling that black man out of his name. His mistake is not him, it's his mistake. Stop calling that black man out of his name in front of his children. Because you teach them to disrespect him. Somebody ought to help me, preacher. My sister-in-law, who's married to my oldest brother, who's going to be with the Lord, my sister-in-law and he got divorced. His first wife, they were divorced. And he has two children with his first wife who is a Filipino woman. I ain't with that, but he married a Filipino woman. But I love Pat. I still love her today. My brother's in his grave, and he and Pat were divorced, but I still consider her my sister-in-law for this reason. Her oldest child was criticizing her daddy in her mama's presence. And Pat slapped the hell out of Monica. And she and my brother were divorced. But she slapped Monica in her face and said, don't ever speak that way about your father. Because what he and I had is our business. He took care of you. Shut your mouth about him. And we need some black women to tell their children, shut your mouth about your daddy. What he and I had is between us, but he is your father, and respect him even though he ain't doing what he ought to do, because God's gonna take care of you. Jesus called Lazarus by his name. But here's the shout. If he had just said, come forth, Abraham would have got up. Jacob would have got up. Somebody ought to help me. Joseph would have got up. Moses would have got up. It wasn't time for the resurrection. It was time for a resuscitation. And what these black men need in our community is a resuscitation. For us to tell them that all hope is not lost. There's a God somewhere. Have I got a witness? I'm trying to close here. Jesus said, come forth. And when Lazarus came out of the grave, he still had on his grave clothes. He was still bound with his grave clothes. He was living, but bound. He was alive, but bound. And these black boys are getting out of jail alive, but bound. They're coming back to our communities alive, but bound. Jesus said, loose him and let him go. Because he ain't no good to me, bound. Somebody ought to help me preach it. Loose him.
He's paid his debt to society. Let him get his driver's license again. Let him rent an apartment again. Let him get a job again. Stop sending him back to jail for a parole violation. And you let white boys rape girls in colleges and give them 3 months suspended sentence. I'm through now. But if the Lord don't help us, I wish I had somebody to help me. I'm through now. But here's the real shout. Lazarus is up, out of the grave. And when you read chapter 12, Jesus has been invited to dinner. I wish I had a Bible reader. You got to read the Bible to shout right here. Jesus is invited to dinner. And he's reclining at the table. And the Bible says, guess who has come to dinner? Lazarus is seated at the table. You're going to help me preach this, won't you? And the Bible says they came not just to see Jesus, but to see Lazarus, who he had raised from the dead. And somebody is in this church this morning, not just to see Jesus, but to see somebody who's been raised from the dead. If the Lord loose you from your grave clothes, if the Lord open the tomb where your dead body was, then you ought to show up here this morning and give God your best hallelujah. Let somebody know, I was dead, but I'm alive again. I was lost, but now I'm found. Is there anybody here who glad Jesus raised you? Is there anybody here got your own resuscitation story? You are on your way to hell, but the Lord turned you around. And if you're glad this morning that God raised you from your dead situation, why don't you grab somebody? Why don't you help me tell somebody, I was dead, but the Lord saved me. I was lost, but the Lord came and found me. I didn't know his name, but the Lord gave me another chance. If the Lord been good to you, why don't you help me praise his name? If the Lord opened doors for you, why don't you help me magnify his name? I've assumed that all of us know who he is, but there might be somebody here this morning who don't know who Jesus is. So let me take a minute to introduce him to you. He's a rock in a weary land. He's a shelter in a time of storm. He's a friend when you're friendless, bread when you're hungry, water when you're thirsty. Y'all know him, don't you? He's Adam's redeemer, Abel's vindicator. He's Abraham's sacrifice. He's Noah's ark. He's Moses' bush on fire. Y'all know him, don't you? He's God's only son. He's Mary's baby boy. He's James and Jude's older brother. He's a distinctive in supernatural capacity, superlative in sovereign majesty, exclusive in spiritual beauty, and radiant in eternal splendor. He's the God of gods. He's the Prince of princes. He's the fairest of 10,000. He's the bright and the morning star. He's the rose of Sharon. He's the lily of the valley. Y'all know him, don't you? He died. Didn't he die? But early Sunday morning, he got up. Didn't he get up? Did he get up in you? I said, did he get up in you? Shake somebody's hand. tell them, you see my glory, but you don't know my story. You see me praising God this morning, but you don't know what I've been through. Shake somebody else's hand. Tell them, in spite of all I've been through, I still have joy. Joy, joy. I know he walks with me. He talks with me. Have you tried him? Won't he raise you up? I know he's all right.
Police can't help us. Politicians can't help us. Nobody but the Lord. Nobody but the Lord. I was going to ask you to do it at 11 o'clock because more children will be here. But some of you have children in here right now. Here's what I want you to do right now. If your child is in this sanctuary, get up right now and go hug him or her, because this might be the last time you see. That's what kind of country we're living in. That's what kind of day and time we're living in. Hug your baby right now and tell her, I'm not going to let the devil have you. I'm not going to let the streets have you. I'm not going to let the drug dealer have you. I'm not going to let the police kill you. I'm going to discipline you myself. Hallelujah. 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 God is still raising dead people. God is still lifting dead people. God is still raising dead.